Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Peg and Rose Stir Up Trouble by Laurien Berenson. Narrated by Margaret Strom. Chapter 1.
Must like dogs,
Rose Donovan said as she typed the words onto the computer screen in front of her. You're crazy, Peg Turnbull replied. The two women were in Rose's office at the Gallagher House, a women's shelter in Stamford, Connecticut. Rose, an amiable woman in her late 60s, had co-founded the shelter earlier in the year with her husband, Peter. The cramped office had formerly served as a storage room in the repurposed three-story home. It offered only enough space for a desk, a file cabinet, and a somewhat battered rubber plant. Rose deleted what she'd written and tried again.
Must love dogs?
No, Peg said firmly. Rose was seated behind the desk. She had short gray hair and pleasant features. Her body was as slender as a twig, with skinny arms and skinny legs to match. Her typing paused. Fingers hovering above the keyboard, Rose glanced upward. Peg, who was 4 years older, was standing just behind her. As usual, the woman seemed to take up more space than she was entitled to. Tall and broad-shouldered, Peg had a linebacker's build, coupled with an equally forceful personality. Rose frowned at her, exasperated.
Then what do you want me to write? Must adore dogs to the exclusion of all else?
Peg grinned wolfishly. That sounds about right. But as you know perfectly well, it's a moot point because I don't want you to write anything.
Don't be silly.
Rose started typing again.
This is a brilliant idea.
It's the worst idea ever. An orange and white kitten was observing the interaction from the top of the file cabinet. Marmalade had been in residence at the shelter for a little more than a month. In that short amount of time, she'd already witnessed several arguments between the two women, so this was nothing new. Since both women were ignoring her, the kitten hopped down from her perch and padded across the hardwood floor to the beleaguered rubber plant. One of its shiny leaves drooped down to her level. Marmalade lifted a dainty paw and gave it a swat. For starters, Peg said, why would anyone name a dating site Mature Mingle?
Because it's an appropriately descriptive name, Rose retorted. You're mature, and you're seeking an opportunity to mingle.
No, you're seeking that opportunity for me. Not only that, but at my age, I'm well past mature. In fact, I think I might be entering my second childhood. To illustrate that point, Peg crossed her legs and sat down on the floor. Marmalade blinked her green eyes in Peg's direction, then went back to attacking the plant.
Hold that thought.
Rose pulled up a new screen.
It's perfect. I'm describing your personality as playful.
I tried online dating once before, Peg mentioned. It was a complete disaster. Maybe that would slow Rose down.
I've heard.
Staring at Peg's nascent dating profile, Rose didn't even bother to turn around.
Melanie told me all about it. One bad experience and you gave up. I thought you had more gumption than that.
Until his death a decade earlier, Peg had been married to Rose's older brother, Max. The two women were sisters-in-law. Previously long estranged, and now feeling their way toward a tentative rapprochement. Melanie's father had been Rose and Max's sibling, so she was both women's niece. I have plenty of gumption, Peg grumbled. I'm also capable of learning from my mistakes. Rose was undeterred.
That was years ago. Now you're older and wiser. Plus, you have me to help you sort through your potential dates.
As if that was a plus. Peg snorted under her breath. A decade earlier, Rose had left the Convent of Divine Mercy to marry a former priest. So clearly, her talents in that regard were highly suspect. It's not as though you have copious experience with men, she said. If Peter hadn't been posted to your parish, the two of you would never have met. That bald statement finally had the desired effect. Rose ceased typing. She turned slowly in her seat. She was only trying to be helpful. And, as usual, Peg wasn't even slightly appreciative of her efforts. Rose was about to give Peg a piece of her mind when she saw the long, shiny strands of a shredded leaf littering the floor. Instead, Rose sighed.
Marmy, cut that out.
The kitten flicked her white-tipped tail. She turned away from the plant and wound herself around Rose's leg.
Good kitty, Peg murmured.
Rose shot her a look.
How is she a good kitty? She's killing my rubber plant.
That was then. Peg braced a hand on the floor and levered herself up. Now she's a good kitten because she stopped when you asked her to. So you should tell her so. Rose reached down and scratched behind Marmalade's ears.
I thought you didn't know anything about cats.
I don't. But I know dogs, and also how to modify behavior with positive reinforcement. If you want Marmalade to learn how to behave, you have to teach her the right way to do so. Rose sighed again. That was another annoying thing about Peg. She was bossy, and she was always sure she knew best, although this time maybe she did.
Forget about the kitten, she said. Will behavior modification work on you?
It's doubtful, Peg replied. I'm pretty set in my ways. Rose certainly wasn't about to argue with that.
I felt that way once, too, she admitted, as though I knew exactly what the rest of my life would look like because it was already mapped out in front of me.
Peg started to interrupt. Rose held up a hand to shush her. Amazingly, it had the desired effect.
Then I met Peter and fell in love. I left the convent and got married. And suddenly, it felt as though my whole world went from black and white to technicolor. It was an utterly amazing feeling, one that I want you to experience too. You deserve to meet a man and be happy again.
I am happy. Peg's reply was firm. And I already did the whole falling madly in love thing with Max. Our life together was wonderful. But I'm not naive enough to believe that I could be that lucky twice in a lifetime. Max was one of a kind.
I get that, Rose nodded. But you don't have to fall in love again. Maybe you could just enjoy spending time with a stimulating companion.
I thought you and I were working on being friends after all these years, Peg said, arching a brow. Now it sounds as though you're trying to pawn me off.
One can never have too many friends, especially not at our age.
Rose trailed her fingertips down Marmy's back.
You know perfectly well that's true.
Peg really wanted to toss back a snappy retort, except that all at once she suspected Rose was right. Most of Peg's friends were retired now. Some had moved out of state to be closer to family. A few had passed away. Even the ranks of her fellow dog show exhibitors seemed to be thinning. Peg definitely wasn't looking to find love. But maybe it wouldn't hurt to broaden her circle of acquaintances. She leaned down, looking over Rose's shoulder to skim through the information on the screen. It appeared to be mostly complete. Then again, what did she know? She'd never seen a dating profile before. Is that everything? Peg asked.
Almost. Rose swiveled around to face the desk. Just a few more questions. Any piercings or tattoos?
Peg barked out a laugh. You're kidding, right?
Rose shrugged. I already answered all the stuff I knew without asking.
So you think, Peg replied mysteriously. Rose refused to rise to that bait.
Date of birth?
Absolutely not. Peg reared back. I have no intention of having my identity stolen from a dating site. Let them look at my photograph and guess how old I am.
About that, Rose said. You need a picture for the profile.
So get out your phone and take one.
Rose stared up at her. Now?
Why not?
Don't you want to?
Rose flapped her hands like she was trying to communicate something. Peg had no idea what, and considering the subject matter, she had no intention of hazarding a guess. After a moment, Rose sputtered on.
Comb your hair? Maybe change your shirt and put on some lipstick?
Peg cast a glance downward. What's the matter with my shirt?
For one thing, it's a t-shirt.
Seriously, did Rose even have to point that out?
For another, it says Ox Ridge Hunt Club across the front.
I'm sure the Kennel Club won't mind. I judge their dog show every fall.
Now you're being deliberately obtuse.
Yes, Peg supposed she was. You're saying I should fix myself up.
Bingo!
You want me to make myself look like someone I'm not?
No,
Rose replied with the patience of a saint. Somehow, when she'd begun this project, she hadn't envisioned Peg tossing quite so many roadblocks in her own path.
I just thought that since first impressions count, you might want to present the best possible version of yourself.
If I change everything, what will my date think when he sees me in person? Maybe he won't even recognize me. No, I'm sorry. Mystery Man will just have to take me as I am.
Men, Rose said.
Pardon me?
Mystery Men. There will be more than one. Nobody gets it right on the first attempt.
Peg laughed at that. I'll be lucky if even one man responds to my profile. You're an outrageous optimist if you're thinking in multiples. Rose was an optimist. She prided herself on looking for the good in everyone. Even Peg, who sometimes required more effort than most.
Why wouldn't multiple men respond?
She replied stoutly.
You're an interesting and accomplished woman.
That's very true, Peg acknowledged. And yet the thing that will be of most interest to the men on your dating site is what I look like.
Precisely,
Rose agreed. She reached across the desk for her purse.
And that's why we need to be sure to take a good picture.
10 minutes later, Rose pronounced Peg ready for her close-up. She'd begun the mini makeover by freeing Peg's shoulder-length hair from its low ponytail at the nape of her neck.
Your hair is thick and shiny,
she said as she coaxed several gray tendrils forward to curl around Peg's face.
You should wear it loose more often.
If I do that, it gets in my way. Rose ignored the comment and dug around in her purse.
Lipstick?
Peg accepted the tube, opened it, swiveled out the stick, and stared at it.
Pale peach,
Rose said impatiently.
Surely even you can't find fault with that.
Peg dabbed a bit of lipstick on her pinky finger, then transferred it to her lips. Better?
Getting there.
Rose reached up, way up, since Peg towered over her, just as she towered over most people their age, and pinched Peg's cheeks with her fingertips.
Ow! Don't be a ninny. That didn't hurt.
Rose took out her phone.
I'll shoot you from the shoulders up so your shirt doesn't show. Now lift your chin and try to look dashing. Perfect. And smile.
Peg blinked the first time the camera clicked. Then she grimaced for the second take.
Third time's the charm,
Rose informed her.
Otherwise, I'm going to have to pinch your cheeks again.
The threat worked. Peg managed to compose herself and smiled at the same time. Good enough, she said, glancing at the image on Rose's phone. Now upload the picture and we're finished, right?
Rose bent down to the computer once more. Unless you want to look around the site and scroll through some of the men's profiles. It's a two-way street, you know. You don't have to wait for them to come to you.
Heaven forbid, Peg muttered. How come you know so much about this stuff anyway? Should Peter be concerned?
Hardly, Rose laughed as she straightened. Online dating is a hot topic here at the shelter. Women who are staying with us often pass the time browsing on dating apps. Some are only window shopping, but others are hoping to find someone who'll treat them better than the abusive jerk they were with.
Good for them. Peg sat down in Rose's chair. Without waiting for an invitation, Marmalade hopped up into her lap. Absently, Peg scratched beneath the kitten's chin.
And then there's Maura, Rose said. It seems like she's signed up for every single dating site there is.
Peg was acquainted with Maura Nettles, the shelter's live-in housekeeper. She admired the woman's strong work ethic and practical approach to life. Maura wasn't a dog lover, however. Peg intended to keep working on that. That sounds exhausting, she said. How many dates has Maura had?
None that I know of. But she keeps trying. She's looking for the perfect man, and she's convinced he's out there somewhere.
Rose reached around Peg, grasped the mouse, and made several adjustments to the page on the screen. Then Peg heard an audible click, and Rose grinned at her.
You're alive, she said.
In the moment, Peg couldn't decide whether to feel hopeful or horrified. She picked up the kitten and lowered her to the floor. So now what happens?
Now we wait and see who contacts you.
Rose smirked. Peg wasn't a wait-and-see kind of person. She was more the everything-should-happen-right-now type.
Unless you've changed your mind about taking the initiative.
Peg shook her head. I allowed you to sign me up. That's as much initiative as I can stand for one day.
Your choice, Rose said blithely.
Under the circumstances, Peg could only envy her nonchalance.
In that case, it's out of our hands. But I have a good feeling about this, Peg. Brace yourself. Online dating just might turn out to be your next big adventure.
Chapter 2. The Gallagher House was located on an older, moderately run-down street in Midtown Stamford. Too close to the busy Connecticut Turnpike to be of interest to affluent millennials or real estate flippers, the area had yet to be gentrified, like its more attractive neighbors. A row of tall, narrow houses, each situated on a tiny plot of land, lined both sides of the road. Some had been maintained as family homes during their decades of existence. Others had passed from one set of careless hands to the next and were now plainly showing their age. The building that housed the women's shelter had belonged to the Gallagher family since the middle of the previous century. Beatrice Gallagher helped Peter and Rose found the shelter, then bequeathed the home to them upon her death earlier in the year. The three-story building had a multitude of windows and a narrow, covered porch. The steps leading up to the front door were newly repaired, but a row of shingles on the porch roof above was beginning to work its way loose.
There was always something that needed to be repaired, replaced, or covered with a fresh coat of paint,
Rose thought as she walked back inside after seeing Peg off. As soon as she and Peter managed to fix one thing, something else broke down. Even with grants, charitable donations, and funding from the city budget, money was always tight. Rose often felt as though she had to pinch every single penny before letting it slip through her fingers. Then again, having recently spent several years on a mission trip to Honduras, where she and Peter had lived in a tin-roofed hut, cohabitating with more varieties of insects than she'd previously known existed, Rose was well aware of how comfortable her life was now. Clean, hot and cold running water? Check. Accommodations that weren't toppled by a strong wind? Also check. Not to mention the luxury of fresh milk for her coffee each morning. As Rose shut the front door behind her, Peter came walking down the stairs from the second floor. Nearing 70, he was a thoughtful and perceptive man who had degrees in counseling and social work. When Peter wasn't making repairs or grimacing over the Gallagher House ledgers, he served as resident counselor for the women who'd sought refuge in the shelter. He had kind eyes, a ready smile, and an innate ability to draw people in and make them feel at ease in his company. Now, however, her normally affable husband was frowning. Rose stopped in her tracks.
Trouble? She asked.
Two women sitting in the living room to the left of the front hall immediately lifted their heads. Liz had been at the shelter for nearly a week. Jules had arrived just the night before with a tear-stained face and only the clothes on her back. Under the circumstances, Rose's question had clearly been ill-considered. She quickly turned to step into the wide doorway.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to alarm you. Everything's fine. I was merely talking to Peter.
He came over and joined her. Fine is a relative term. I've just been up on the third floor. Jenny's son, Rocky, flushed his sister's doll's head down the toilet. Jenny and her two children had currently taken over most of the shelter's top floor. Jenny's 3-year-old daughter, Belle, was adorable, but 5-year-old Rocky was a menace. Rose knew it wasn't charitable to think such thoughts, but she would definitely be relieved when Jenny's sister arrived in a few days to take the family home with her.
Just the head?
Liz asked with a grin. Yes, although that was bad enough. I managed to retrieve it and unclog the plumbing. But I'm afraid, Sissy, the doll is a lost cause. Peter's statement was punctuated by a loud wail that traveled down the stairwell from the top of the house.
Maybe not.
Jules hopped up.
I grew up with 5 brothers and sisters, so I'm an old hand at resuscitating dead toys. Come on, Liz. Let's see what we can do to help.
Liz rolled her eyes as she walked past them. Apparently, she agreed with Peter's assessment of the situation. Nevertheless, she followed Jules up the steps.
That was nice of them,
Rose said. A person who always tried to be helpful herself, it made her happy when other people took the initiative to do the same. I wish them luck. Peter didn't sound optimistic. The doll's hair is tangled in a huge knot, and I think she's missing an eye. And that doesn't even address the problem of how to reattach the head to the body.
Hopefully, Jules will surprise you. And if nothing else, working on Sissy will take her mind off her own problems for a while.
It was late August, so all the windows in the house were open. When a car backfired on the street outside, the noise was so loud it sounded as though a gun had gone off in the hallway. Rose hurried over to the window to have a look. The vehicle in question had to be at least 20 years old. A low-slung sedan, it might have once been red, but now its color had faded to a sickly shade of dusty rose. One dented and mismatched fender wasn't painted at all. There was a tear in the car's vinyl roof, and judging by the loud rumble coming from the street, its muffler had been removed. As Rose watched, the car moved past the shelter, leaving a trail of exhaust in its wake. The driver pulled over to the curb in front of a house at the end of the block. Rose pulled her head back inside. She was turning around to say something to Peter when Maura burst into the hallway from the direction of the kitchen.
"What the hell was that?" she asked.
"Backfire," Rose told her.
"Thank God."
The housekeeper wore an apron over her faded jeans. She used it to wipe off her flour-covered hands.
"I was afraid the porch roof had collapsed."
"Not yet," Peter said cheerfully.
"If you're trying to reassure me, it's not working."
Maura was in her late 30s and solidly built. She had short, no-fuss brown hair, 5 piercings in each ear, and a can-do attitude toward life. Originally, she'd arrived at the shelter in need of protection. Several weeks later, after she'd all but taken over managing the place, it had become clear to Peter and Rose that they needed her help as much as she needed theirs. At that point, Maura had moved into the basement apartment and become the shelter's resident cook and housekeeper.
"I'm trying to be truthful," Peter said.
"Frankly, I'd prefer reassurance." Maura walked over to join Rose at the window. While they were talking, a second car came down the road from the opposite direction and parked in front of the same house. 3 men, who looked to be in their 20s, hopped out of the 2 cars and went inside the home. Rose noted that they hadn't stopped to knock. One of the men had a key. Rose wasn't at all sure she liked the looks of that.
"What's the matter?"
Peter asked. He knew Rose well enough that even from across the room he could tell that she was troubled.
"Mrs. Mayberry has visitors."
"Oh?"
He came over to have a look.
"Anyone we know?"
"No."
Rose frowned.
3 rather rough-looking young men just let themselves into her house. I hope Mrs. Mayberry was expecting them."
When they'd first moved onto the block, Peter and Rose had introduced themselves to each of the surrounding homeowners. They'd explained the mission of the Gallagher house and emphasized that they intended to be respectful of their neighbors' privacy and mindful of the fact that the shelter was located in a mostly residential area. No one had objected. Indeed, some residents, Mrs. Mayberry among them, considered the shelter to be a welcome upgrade to the slowly deteriorating neighborhood. Now Peter stared at the 2 cars at the end of the block. Neither was in good condition, and one had a layer of mud covering its license plate. Peter liked to keep an eye on things, and this looked worrisome.
"I haven't met Mrs. Mayberry," Maura said, considering.
"But around here, anything's possible. Maybe she likes hanging out with young men. Could be they're down there playing poker and smoking cigars."
"I highly doubt that," Rose replied. "Mrs. Mayberry's in her 80s. She's healthy enough for her age, but she's also frail and probably not as sharp as she used to be. I think I should take a walk down there and check things out."
"I'll come with you," Peter said.
"No."
Rose immediately shook her head.
"I don't want to make a big deal of this, especially if it turns out to be nothing. For all we know, Maura is right, and Mrs. Mayberry is entertaining guests. But just in case, I think I'll take a stroll past her house and see what there is to see."
Maura and Peter shared a look.
"I feel like taking a stroll, too," Maura announced.
Rose glanced down at her apron.
"You're in the middle of baking."
"Just muffins. They can wait."
"And don't you give me that look," she said to Rose as she whipped off the apron and tossed it on a nearby tabletop. "You know you're a scrawny thing. It won't hurt to have someone with a few muscles standing next to you."
"I have an even better idea," Peter offered. "The kitchen is overflowing with tomatoes. Maura, why don't you put some in a basket and the 2 of you can take them down to Mrs. Mayberry? Maybe she'd like to share them with her guests.
Perfect, Rose agreed. That'll get us inside the house.
5 minutes later, Rose and Maura were out the door and on their way. Maura was in front, carrying a woven basket filled to the brim with ripe red tomatoes. The size of Rose's summer crop ensured that they had plenty to spare. Rose, in sneakers, had to step carefully over the cracked and pitted sidewalk, but she was close behind. They'd barely gone halfway down the block when the air around them began to pulse with the sound of loud music. It was blasting through the open windows of the house at the end of the street.
I don't think Mrs. Mayberry is a fan of rap, Rose said.
Good thing.
Maura peered at her over the rim of the basket.
That's hip-hop.
Really?
Rose sighed. She'd probably never learn to tell the difference. When they reached the edge of Mrs. Mayberry's property, Maura paused. Rose didn't. Instead, she strode across the minuscule, scrubby yard and marched up the steps to the front door. Here, the music was even louder than it had been on the sidewalk. Rose reached over and rang the doorbell. Nothing happened. She couldn't tell whether that was because the bell was broken or because no one, including her, could hear its ring over the sound of the thumping beat. For her second attempt, she rolled her fingers into a fist and pounded on the door itself.
Jeez, give me a break, someone yelled. I'm coming.
Seconds later, the door drew open. A slender young man with shaggy black hair and an ill-advised soul patch stood in the doorway. He was dressed in a t-shirt and a pair of jeans that would have needed a good yank upward to reach his bony hips. His feet were dirty. Rose could see that because he was wearing flip-flops. He stared at Rose. She stared back. Maura cleared her throat.
These tomatoes are heavy, she said to no one in particular.
I'm just going to put the basket down on the porch. The man ignored her.
What?
He said to Rose. She smiled sweetly in return.
We're looking for Mrs. Mayberry. Is she at home?
He scratched the scraggly stubble on the side of his jaw.
Who wants to know?
I'm Rose, and this is Maura.
Rose nodded in her companion's direction.
We're neighbors from down the street. We brought Mrs. Mayberry some tomatoes from our garden.
The guy leaned over and looked inside the basket as if he suspected they might be trying to smuggle contraband into the house. His attitude was really beginning to get on Rose's nerves. She was considering picking up a tomato and tossing it at him when he turned back into the house and yelled,
Hey, Gran, there's someone here to see you.
Gran? Rose and Maura looked at each other. Apparently, this insolent kid was family. Rose supposed that put a new spin on things. They waited for half a minute, but Mrs. Mayberry didn't appear. Abruptly, the man spun around and strode away. It was no wonder Mrs. Mayberry hadn't heard his call, Rose decided. This close to the source of the music, she could barely hear herself think. Left in the open doorway, she peered inside the house. Its floor plan was similar to that of the shelter. From there, she could see into the living room, where the other two men were sprawled across a couch, their gazes fastened on a video game that was playing on a screen in front of them. As Rose watched, one of them blew something up, then pumped his fist in the air. She turned away and saw Mrs. Mayberry approaching from the other end of the hallway. Rose wasn't tall, but this woman was tiny. Her head, capped by a halo of wispy white hair, barely came to Rose's chin. Mrs. Mayberry's blue eyes were watery, and there was an uncertain smile on her face.
Hello, dear,
she said, holding out a wavering hand for Rose to shake.
It's lovely to meet you.
Rose's heart sank. Then she gathered herself and smiled.
Yes, it's lovely to see you too.
She gently clasped the woman's fingers.
I'm Rose, and this is Maura. We run the women's shelter down the block, and we've brought you some tomatoes from our garden.
That's nice,
Mrs. Mayberry said as Maura picked up the basket so she could see it. Rose leaned in closer.
And we wanted to make sure that you're all right. Are you?
Yes, dear. I'm fine. My grandson, Donnie, came to visit and brought his friends. Are we making too much noise?
Maybe a little bit, Maura told her. The older woman nodded.
I'll ask the boys to turn it down.
Rose tried again.
Do you need anything, Mrs. Mayberry? Is there something we can do to help you?
The older woman blinked several times, taking a moment to refocus her thoughts.
It's kind of you to offer, but as you can see, I have my grandson here. Donnie will get me anything I need. Thank you for dropping by.
Donnie couldn't have been far away because now he suddenly materialized in the doorway. He grasped his grandmother's arm and drew her back into the house. That's enough, he said. He took the basket from Maura, then shut the door in their faces. Rose and Maura didn't say a word until they were back on the sidewalk heading home. Then Maura blew out a breath.
That was interesting.
I agree,
Rose replied. She wasn't at all sure what to make of the encounter.
But at least now we know that Donnie is family, which means that those three aren't just random delinquents who've helped themselves to her home. I hope that means everything is all right.
I hope Mrs. Mayberry likes tomatoes, Maura said. Chapter 3. Wait and see, Peg thought as she drove home to her house in Greenwich. What a terrible idea that was. And how like Rose to blithely assume that something beneficial would result from this silly escapade. Now that she had time for second thoughts, Peg realized she must have been out of her mind to go along with Rose's scheme. Well, it was too late to back out now. Her profile was live, as opposed to her love life, which had been all but moribund for years. Not that she expected this dubious venture to revive it. In fact, it seemed more than likely that nothing would happen at all. Peg's best plan would probably be to wait until several weeks had passed, then quietly deactivate the profile and put the whole sorry episode behind her. The less said about it, the better. Peg lived in backcountry Greenwich, where spacious properties abounded and meandering lanes were lined with century-old stone walls. Many years earlier, her house had been the hub of a working farm. Now only 5 acres of property remained. That was plenty of room for Peg and the 3 standard poodles with whom she currently shared her home. When her husband Max was still alive, there had been many more poodles in residence, enough to fill both the house and a kennel building behind it. Peg's life back then was a whirl of constant activity as she and Max exhibited standard poodles from the renowned Cedar Crest Kennel at dog shows up and down the East Coast. Now Max was gone, and Peg was on her own. And although she still attended numerous shows each year, these days, she seldom exhibited. Instead, Peg put all her years of experience in the dog world to good use as a popular and highly esteemed dog show judge. She turned off the main road and let the minivan coast down her secluded road. As soon as the 2 chimneys that bracketed her peaked roofline came into view, she began to smile. The 2 adult bitches, Hope and Coral, and younger dog Joker, would all be waiting for her. Before she even had a chance to park in front of the garage, 3 black poodle heads were already popping up in the front windows of the house. Peg hopped out of the van and went skipping up the steps to the door. Skipping, she thought happily. At my age. Imagine that. Rose would probably think it was ridiculous, but poodles always had that effect on Peg. Actually, dogs of any kind would do it. And what Rose wasn't here to see wouldn't hurt either one of them. When she opened the door, the trio of poodles came tumbling out in a rush. All three dogs were large in size and similar in shape. Hope, at 11, wasn't as sprightly as the younger poodles, but the depth of her emotional connection with Peg was stronger than ever. Coral was a young beauty who'd recently been handled to her championship by Melanie's older son, Davy. Joker had just turned a year old. Still a puppy at heart, he was the clown of the group and more than willing to live up to his name. "Did anybody miss me?" Peg asked, dropping to her knees. Immediately, she was swarmed by warm, wriggling bodies. Her chest was bumped. Her nose was licked. Joker even managed to slap the pom-pom on the end of his tail across her face. Peg, with both hands busy trying to caress all three big poodles at once, was in heaven. 2 minutes of general mayhem passed before they all paused to take a deep breath. Peg finally stood up. Dogs dancing around her legs, she led the way through the kitchen to the back door. Having spent the morning cooped up inside, the poodles were in need of a potty break. As they raced past her to the enclosed field behind the house, Peg's eye went to her laptop. When she'd departed earlier, she'd left it sitting on the butcher block table in the middle of the room. Now that she'd noticed it sitting there, she couldn't seem to look away. It was almost as if the dreaded device was calling out to her, mockingly. Like it knew that her profile was on the Mature Mingle website, probably being ignored by scores of older men who'd glanced at her picture, then scrolled by thinking they could do better. Peg harrumphed under her breath. She'd never been a beauty, but she was well aware of her own worth. She was smart, hardworking, and endlessly curious about life. Plus, she had a robust sense of humor. Those attributes had always been more than enough for Max, and for her beloved standard poodles. That settled it, Peg decided. Why delay for several futile weeks when she could log into Mature Mingle and delete her profile right now? Rose might mutter and mumble in protest, but at least she wouldn't have the last laugh. Peg pulled out a chair and sat down. She opened the laptop and frowned at the screen. An icon in the corner told her she had mail waiting. She sighed, fingers drumming on the table beside the keyboard. Rose had spent nearly an hour that morning working on her profile. Perhaps rather than doing something rash, Peg should pause and consider her options. She could check her mail in the meantime. When she clicked the icon, a long list of emails appeared. There was nothing new. She'd get around to answering most of them eventually. What was new, however, was the message at the top of the page. It was from the dating site. Peg stared at the screen for several seconds. Perhaps Mature Mingle merely wanted to congratulate her on joining up. Or maybe they'd written to inform her that she needed to post a better photograph. If that was the case, Peg thought she might replace her picture with a lovely photo of Hope. Let those hypothetical prospective suitors try to figure that out. Oh, for Pete's sake, Peg told herself. Just open the darn thing and see what they want. Then she did, and her eyes widened. Mature Mingle had sent a congratulatory message to let her know that there had been recent activity on her page. The email supplied a link and invited her to come and check it out. Recent activity? Scarcely an hour had passed since Rose had activated her profile. Surely they couldn't mean... Peg clicked on the link. There was her own picture staring back at her. The other information she'd furnished was below it. A blinking star at the bottom of the page indicated that she had messages waiting to be read. Messages? Plural? Peg was astounded. How was that even possible? It had to be some kind of mistake. Maybe there was a glitch in the software. Peg was about to find out when Coral came flying up the steps from the yard and into the kitchen. Joker and Hope followed close behind. Peg had left the back door open, but she hadn't expected the trio of poodles to return at this rate of speed. All three dogs went skidding through the kitchen to the hallway that led to the front door. That could only mean one thing. Her canine alarm system was alerting her that someone was here. A moment later, as Peg stood up, the doorbell rang. "Good dogs," she said automatically. Peg was talking to herself. The poodles were already at the front door. They adored all visitors. Peg used to feel much the same way, but events earlier in the summer had taught her to be more cautious. She paused to glance out the kitchen window. A Volvo station wagon was parked in her driveway. Peg recognized the car. Even better, a black standard poodle who looked just like Hope was trotting around her front yard, checking out all the interesting smells. That was Faith, Hope's little sister. Peg's niece, Melanie, had come to visit. Luckily for Melanie, she was still in the driveway when Peg opened the door. Otherwise, she'd have been bowled over by the three big dogs who went racing down the steps. Then it occurred to Peg that Melanie was accustomed to that kind of greeting. She'd probably timed her entrance to avoid the oncoming horde. Peg smiled at the thought. Despite the many fractured relationships in their family, she and Melanie had been best friends for years. Ever since the theft of one of Peg's dogs had brought them together to solve the crime. Peg had rewarded her niece, who'd never previously owned a pet, with the gift of Faith. Now Melanie lived with her husband and two sons in a house that was overflowing with dogs. Peg considered that a job well done on her part. "You're lucky you caught me," she said, standing in her doorway. Now there were four black standard poodles gamboling around her front yard. Nothing unusual about that. "I just got home a few minutes ago." "I should have called first." Melanie shaded her eyes against the sun and gazed upward. She turned 40 on her previous birthday, but she still possessed the slender build of a teenager. Straight, tawny brown hair hung below her shoulders, and she was dressed casually in a polo shirt and skinny jeans. "Faith and I were out running errands, and I decided I was in the mood for cake." "Cake?" Peg's face lit up. Her sweet tooth was legendary. She always had cake. "You've come to the right place."
"I know."
Melanie was just as pleased about that as Peg was. She climbed the steps while the dogs were otherwise occupied.
"You lot," Peg called to the cavorting poodles, "come inside before I close the door."
All four dogs quickly came running. When the group reached the kitchen, Peg went to refill the poodles' bowls with cold water. Melanie was on her way to the refrigerator when she passed by the table and glanced at the computer screen. Immediately, she stopped and turned back. "What's this?" Water was running in the sink. Peg had a full dog bowl in each hand. Otherwise, she might have been able to move faster. "It's nothing," she said firmly. Melanie leaned down for a closer look.
"It doesn't look like nothing."
Peg placed both bowls on the floor, then strode over to the table. She reached out and snapped the laptop shut. Melanie jumped back just in time.
"Oh my God!"
Melanie bit her lip like she was trying not to laugh.
"That was you! On a dating site!"
It wasn't as if Peg could refute that. Instead, she propped her hands on her hips and went on the offensive.
"So?"
Melanie looked dumbfounded. That obviously wasn't the answer she'd been expecting. She pulled out a chair and sat down at the table.
Clearly, she'd forgotten all about the cake.
So this is exciting, she said. Tell me everything.
It isn't exciting at all, Peg retorted. The whole thing was Rose's doing, and you know Rose. She's never had an exciting idea in her life.
Melanie leaned back and crossed her arms over her chest. What I know about you and Rose is that the two of you were barely speaking to each other earlier in the summer before Sam and I took the boys on vacation. And by the time we got back, you'd somehow become friends. She paused, then added, I thought that was exciting.
I think the word you're looking for is unexpected.
That too.
Peg sat down across from her and affected a nonchalant shrug, as if the development hadn't surprised her too. Her reconciliation with Rose still felt too fragile for Peg to want to discuss it, much less try and explain how it had come about.
It was simply time for Rose and me to mend our relationship, she said with a finality that pronounced the subject closed. Now, are we going to eat cake or not? The bakery had a new flavor, hazelnut buttercream. It would be a shame to leave it sitting in the box.
Of course we're having cake.
Melanie jumped up again. I'll serve.
Several minutes later, Peg and Melanie each had a generous piece of hazelnut cake on a plate in front of them. The poodles had all had water and were settled on the cool kitchen floor around them. Peg waited patiently until Melanie had devoured half her slice. Then she said, Much as I enjoy your visits, I know perfectly well you didn't drop by to eat cake. So I'm assuming something must be wrong. What is it?
I'm in need of a second opinion. Peg relaxed. That sounded easy enough. She was full of opinions. Not only that, but she was always happy to share them.
Go on.
As you know, Kevin will be starting first grade next week.
Peg nodded. Melanie's younger son was 6. Her older son, Davey, was 15 and in high school. Kevin attended Howard Academy, the private school where Melanie worked weekday mornings as a special needs tutor.
He wants his own cell phone.
What?
That's what I said.
Melanie nodded, pleased at Peg's reaction.
It's a ridiculous idea.
Peg agreed, but she still had questions. What does Sam think about it? Melanie growled something uncomplimentary under her breath. Peg took that to mean that Melanie and her husband weren't on the same page. She cut off another piece of cake and slid it onto Melanie's plate. In Peg's world, cake, followed by more cake, could cure almost any problem.
Pardon me? She said.
Melanie looked up.
Sam's okay with it. He and Davy share the opinion that since Davy has a phone, Kevin should be able to have one too.
Davy is a teenager, Peg pointed out unnecessarily. That's totally different.
Of course it is. But you know what Howard Academy is like. Some of Kevin's classmates had cell phones last year in kindergarten, so he feels left out.
Set on a knoll overlooking downtown Greenwich, Howard Academy had rigorous academic standards and a student body that consisted mostly of offspring of the rich and powerful. Peg could well understand why the school's students would have access to every new and enticing device, but that didn't mean it made sense.
The problem is, I'm outnumbered,
Melanie said, then paused briefly to dig into her second slice of cake.
So I need an ally, like you. Someone forceful and domineering. Someone who can overrule Davy and make Sam listen to reason.
Peg was sympathetic, but only to a point. And Melanie was not only fast approaching that point, she might have already gone flying past it.
Besides,
Melanie gestured with her fork for emphasis,
you know you love to argue.
That was true. Even so, Peg knew it was a terrible idea to insert herself in the middle of someone else's family squabble.
Let me sum up, she said.
You're asking me to do battle with Sam, alienate Davy, and disappoint Kevin, all so that you can avoid doing those things yourself. Melanie swallowed, then nodded. That sounds about right. Of course she would think that. The proposal sounded all wrong to Peg. Maybe if she stalled long enough, like until Kevin was a teenager, the problem would solve itself. Let me get back to you on that, she said. Chapter 4 Rose was sitting in the tiny yard behind the Gallagher house, filling out a grant application. This summer, she'd grown tomatoes back there. Next year, she was planning to add cucumbers. Recently, she'd aerated the hard-packed earth around her small garden, and now patches of grass had begun to appear. Maura didn't think that was much of an accomplishment, but Rose was pleased. Work was boring, so when her phone rang, Rose was just as happy to be distracted. She set her laptop down on the small table beside her wicker lawn chair, picked up the device, and looked to see who was calling. Most people would have started the conversation with a greeting, not Peg. "You'll never believe what happened," she said.
"When it comes to you, I'd believe almost anything," Rose replied.
"What's happened now?" "Men have left messages for me on the Mature Mingle website."
"Of course they have."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.